rocking out with the talk of the shy.
Talk of the shy.
Popping it up with talk of the shy.
And we're live today with talk of the shy.
Quan
and I.
Are you on talk of the shy right now? Tune in with my boy Quan and Don.
Here, talk of the shy. Quan and Don.
Talk of the shy with my boy Quan and Don.
Homie Quan and Don.
Talk of the shot.
So Quan and Don, I was live on Talk of the Shot.
I'm on Talk of the Shot with Quan and Don. Talk of the Shot right here. You feel me? Get in tune. Don't miss out, I swear. It's busted, Jordy, on game.
We're just on Talk of the Shot with my boy Quan and Don.
And I'm here at Talk of the Shot with my boy Quan and Don.
Hey, y'all tune in, man. I was just on Talk of the Shot with your boy Quan and Don, man.
And I was just live on the Talk of the Shot with my boy the Quan and Don.
We're Quan and Don at Talk of the Shot Radio. You see, you know what I'm saying?
Yo, it's your boy Floyd. I'm live on Talk of the Shot Radio with my boy Quan and Don. Y'all make sure y'all stay.
Brand new!
Welcome in to Talk of the Shot. You already know it's your boy Quan and Don. We got a special guest in the building.
Hey, Talk of the Shot has comedian Blair Christian in the building.
Hey,
glad
that part.
Here.
Hey, appreciate you coming on the platform. Hey, so as always, we're gonna get straight to the nitty gritty like we always do. So where you from?
I'm from Chicago. I'm from Uptown.
Facts, say that. Say
so
that.
I'm from Uptown, North Pole. No, and I stay there with a little slight chip because when you come from the north side of Chicago, it's always
it's a
like
rough,
a thing.
Listen, all y'all should be all over there in the park on Sunnyside, on Wilson.
He
ain't gonna do nothing like that.
He probably did his little research and he named the streets like he did.
No, I really used to be up there.
Oh, okay, you born there.
Okay, yeah, you
that's my hand. That's where I'm from. It's actually a really dope community.
Facts.
All facets of life,
facts.
Honestly, in one neighborhood.
Yeah, I know. I was over there being really bad, but that's the past. Don't we talk about that? So, what high school you went to?
I went to Mather, which is not in Uptown.
I was just gonna say that. I was gonna say, what you went to CN?
I know. Well, I was supposed to go to CN. That's where all my people went. But
you went.
I went to Mather because my elementary school was closer to Mather too, so I didn't go to the neighborhood school in the Uptown either. And that was just because they wanted to keep all the kids together. So my brother went to Bell. Shout out to anybody from Bell School.
Facts, that
and
part.
And so then just went straight to Mather.
Okay. So what was life like for you growing up in Chicago?
What? Life was amazing. I tell people like I am from Chicago, like from the city, meaning like, you know, you get some people who like stay on their block, stay on their neighborhood.
Facts.
We literally, as teenagers and kids, traveled the entire city.
Right.
Every, like, once a month, just because I was with, we were a dance troupe initially, full effect. And then, so from that, we would be performing, but all the shows where you want to kind of highlight and be hot at was like out west, out south.
Out south.
You know what I mean? Sometimes south suburbs. So we literally traveled the city in all year.
So kind of
different high schools,
all
that.
Started too. Dance always a passion for you?
Well, my mother said I was dancing at one. And my friend was, I was dipping. She knew, like, she was going to be a dancer. So, but organized, they started. They came into my park district. I was a cheerleader. And it was like, we're starting this new group. It's going to be like the North Side, U5U, a reference, you know, one of the South Side groups, one of the prominent South Side groups. And we was in there and I auditioned. And I was like at 12, 13. And just was in it for like 18 years after that.
Mm.
Yeah, and then it grew and became a theatrical dance company.
Mm.
So it evolved. It was a big part. It's actually a big part of my life and how I started and all the different ventures and stuff like that from theatrical stage dance.
And that was a journey in itself.
Like I said, when you said, when I said Northside, I had that little chip because the street dance, which is like footwork, you know what I mean, ghetto house. Up north, it was like the only team. Out south, you had like five or six teams per south side, west side to battle. So when we come in the gym, they like, where they from? Up north.
I don't know why we be on that.
Like it's so far,
like it's like sweet or something.
Exactly.
But it's really not.
I had friends like, you going all the way up north? Like, yeah, the weather is different up there. Like,
yeah.
No, it's 25 minutes away. Look
no, the that. Weather is different up there for real. It's
well,
a
if you're on the lakefront,
yeah, look.
If you're on the lakefront,
it is a little cold up there now. I'm going to be real.
As opposed to out west. So, okay, two or three degrees.
Them little 2 degrees
and
matter,
that's
though.
Fine.
Look.
But yeah, so yeah, that was, it's a big chunk of like just my entertainment life, full effect, and just evolving and in that process of working. and doing different things and staying fresh and staying like different from everybody else. Just the work we put in. We was putting on, I was putting on theatrical concerts at like 18.
Right. So that was your first love. That was your baby, right?
Yeah.
But like, what kind of made you step out of that? Was you, it did its course? Or?
It was just a natural progression, I think. So when we were, like I say, trying to stay above the rest, we would do skits before the dance routines. And then when we got super savvy, we started recording our own like music videos. And so we would do like, you know, different little anecdotes. We did the Flintstones. We did X-Men. We did a superhero like spoof or whatever, all tied into hip hop dance. Right. So that kind of gave me that kind of comedic timing. It gave me just a bit of just kind of like being in front of the audience and improv and things like that. Right. So it was just natural. But in addition to like putting on the concerts, I started producing comedy shows. So then I was like in it, like I was around it. So that helped too.
When you first started, what you ever like? Really nervous before shows, or like, what was your like pre-game thing?
Well, you know, I used to get my courage juice in Chicago. My courage juice used to consist of Patron and a shot glass.
That part.
And that was it. But I was never, I think, I was never nervous like fearful. Mm-hmm. It was just nervous to perform. So like any stage, like even right now, like if I'm doing like a small room, or it's like in front of 12,000 people, 20,000, it's always the same feeling. Right. Meaning like that nervous because you care about how you do, not that you're fearful that you won't do well. So, but when I went, my first time going up, man, I invited like 50 people out and was telling them like, look, I'm about to become. So half the room was like, what, you crazy? The other half was like, oh yeah, it's gonna be good. So I made everybody come out, all my like the besties, my dad, everybody, like laugh even if it's not funny. Like that was the rule for the night.
Right.
But I prepared. I really prepared. It wasn't something that I took lightly when I decided to be a comedian. I had really researched. I had really, you know, wrote out what I wanted. I had wrote out literally on the plane. I had a show in Brazil, a dancing background, and I wrote out my 1 minute show, my 3 minute show, my HBO special. I had written everything out, so I was. I asked him, I said, how long do I get? He's like, just go. I'm like, wait, what? I understood the culture. I knew it was a light. I knew, you know, you only had a certain amount of minutes, but he said, go. You filled up the room tonight. My first time, I did 20 minutes, 46 seconds. The first time. What? Because I was prepared. And when people gave me a couple of giggles, what?
20 minutes? On the first time?
First time.
Goodness gracious.
I was excited, yeah.
Damn, you had a couple of them jokes for some years and
stuff. No, I did not.
How you had 20 minutes worth of work on the first time going out?
Because I really prepared. Like, I had done the work, and that part was like a 2 week prep.
Because that's not light. You get what I'm saying?
I know.
Like, I'm a hooper, right?
Right.
I wouldn't jump from eighth grade to the pros and just play big minutes. You know what I'm saying? You got to progress into that. I'm ready for it.
I'm sure, it's actually on YouTube, but I'm sure it was a bunch of, like I said, my people were there, so it's more so like, me just acting the fool anyway. Like,
no, that's one of the moments you toot your horn on our show. That's
right.
That's,
yeah,
that's,
girl.
That's, look.
20 minutes, my first time.
She dropped 20 big. You know how that be.
It was like that, and it felt good, and after that, I was in the open mic every night. I was doing whatever show I could. I was doing barbecues, I was doing living rooms. Cause everybody was so geeked, they was like, do it right now. I'm like, okay. I was in people's living rooms, like, so when I came to the thing. Like, it was that energy. Like, I was just going. So, and I was like promoting, talking about, come out tonight, I got new jokes. A comedian told me, a vet comedian was like, look, you don't have to have new material, you just work on what you have. I was like, oh, I thought I needed new jokes every time, so.
No, I found that out the hard way too. I was like, hey, you know, I went to go see somebody somewhere, and then I went to go see them somewhere else,
and
I thought they was gonna say some new jokes.
They
missed a couple,
but
it was low-key the same set, and that's when I was like, oh, that's what it is.
Exactly. It's like, one of the comics said it, like, it's like an artist. He like, if you love my songs, you come to my concert, I'm doing my same songs you love. So I guess
that is true.
In essence, and then two, it's always a new audience. Like, you're not supposed to like perform for the exact same people.
Facts.
So I think in that spirit, moving around. But you know what's so funny it'll make 6 years in December 4th, but I still don't have an actual like set that I think. Like, I have an opening and then I have like some stuff I always do, but that like exact set, like I've watched some like super talented vets and I've done the weekend with them. And I watch them like, dang, he did the same exact thing. Like, how does he do that? I can do it for a weekend. I can kind of keep the same, but the next show, nah, that set changing.
It's all it's weird. Like,
yeah, I try, but I mean, and it's, I mean, it's getting better.
It's that part. Well, y'all know we got a few bills, man. We're gonna take a quick break. Make sure y'all stay tuned right here on Talk with Shy Man, Shoy Quan and Dom. We got this way to build it, man. Hey, we'll be right back. You hear me?
Teenager, I knew that I should have unprotected sex. Once I get titties, I was gonna have an attitude. And then do the freakiest shit you can, and I guess apparently guys like that shit. You know what I'm saying? I didn't stand a chance. So I even know I'm surprised at this music, but I still get surprised. Cause it's a song right out now, you know what I'm saying? Songs back in the day, I mean, they, you know, they some bad shit, they cuss your ass out, right? Track 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, cuss you out. Track 6, give your inspirational song, right? Tupac said, keep your head up, ooh, child, things are gonna get easy. And you like, damn, I know, I feel good. I'll be over here, right to the end. Then after that, you feeling, you know, you feeling good about yourself. No, not to that. And one song, they uplift you, bring your ass right back down within 2 bars. Front song go like this. I say, hey, ladies. Yeah. And you know you.
Welcome back in to Talk of the Shy. As you know, it's your host, Quan and Don. Back to Christian Blair. Hey.
You calling me my name like I got a comma, like I'm filling out documents.
You know what? You got to,
Blair Christian.
Okay, listen, let me tell you something. You gotta be professional at all times. Okay. Okay, because we don't know who going to see this. Okay.
So you're going to do it backwards?
Yes, like, every time. That's how we're going to do it, okay?
Hey, that's fine.
Yeah, so usually I work backwards too. I like working backwards, you know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. I tell Dale Soul first and then, you know,
okay.
That part. So right. You always see it backwards, so they refer to you by, I mean, not to, what I was trying to say.
Your surname.
No, you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
That's the old school stuff. That's this over here. Yeah. You know how you're supposed to be like Miss Whoever. Right. You know what I'm saying? But we don't do that no more. So I try to lead by example. Mm-hmm. That's it. That's
this
all.
This him trying to clean it.
Yeah, I'm trying to clean up my shit. Y'all saw that?
Ugh.
I tried. Look, I almost got away with it. Look. No. No, but outside of that, is there any new projects or anything that you're working on right now?
Always some stuff going on. Just doing different comedy rooms around the nation pretty much. I'm doing riddles this weekend, and it's a fashion show in December, then it's a show in Indianapolis. Oh, and then I'm doing a music video, because I dance too. So I do dance and do dance choreography. So we got a video dropping. I've had the privilege and pleasure of doing working with the iconic Missy Elliott since 2005.
Oh, okay.
So she got another video dropping, so we're gonna work on that. And then that's it. Wildin' Out has got another season, the last like finale. So it's a moment of like other cast members and stuff coming back. So that happens in December.
Pretty much going, it's a go.
Rocking.
Nothing's wrong with that. It's always good.
Be rocking and rolling.
You know what I'm saying? Be putting that work out. You hear me? That's what it's all about, though. But outside of that, what did it kind of take to get to where you are today? Like, what? What did it take from you to get to where you are today? Did you have to sacrifice some things? Did you have to?
Why I did the.
I gotta use the right terminology, because
honestly it was everything was like I said before, natural progression and natural flow. I never as a kid was like, I'm gonna be an entertainer. Like, I was supposed to be a second education, secondary education teacher, English. So I was an English major in college. And but I'd always been dancing all my life, but it was just what we did. Like, that's what you did to kind of stay busy, I guess, off the streets or whatever. And that just became its own engine. And from, like I say, from there, all the other parts came. So I would say what I did consistently was I just worked and I enjoyed everything I was doing. So when we evolved from a troupe and said, man, we want to do a theatrical dance concert and stuff, I was all for it. You know what I mean? I was always open to opportunities.
Facts. That part. Say that part again.
I was always open to opportunities.
That part, yeah.
So when it was like something happened, I'll say, I need your help here, I need this. Oh, I can do it, or I can do it. Or, and so those kind of things made it where I was like, ah, I see this now, and now I want to be a part of it. I started designing clothes and making clothes because we needed costumes. And we exhausted all our resources, and I was like, I'm going to do it. So I just called my mom on the phone, like, how do you make pants? And she kind of told me, and I was in my apartment just kind of freestyling. And from there, it just developed. And then I just started building like prom clients and then wedding clients and then ready to wear. So it just came out of necessity. Yeah, so that was just, like I say, me just being open to opportunities and then just taking advantage of the stuff that like was immediately around me.
Factual. Drop my diamonds, man. It's a diamonds moment, right? You hear me? She's dropping jewels for y'all right now. You hear me? That part.
That's it. Just kind of. And then working too. Like, we worked really hard. When we were like I said, I was producing like 2-hour productions with 32 moving parts at 18, 19. And so I already kind of knew. So when I transitioned to dancing background for artists, you know, actual television artists, it was easy for me to adapt to an 8-hour rehearsal. It was easy for me to, you know, fall in line creatively to understand because I had been training from the ground up from 12, 13 with this dance troupe. And so, that happened, and then, like I say, just from being on the stage and improv, and then that transition to comedy was easier because I had stage time before, so I understood, you know, what the audience needed and that kind of thing. So everything was just kind of just staying with whatever I did, working in it, and making myself like, oh, okay, we need this, we need that, and then it just.
So where does your comedy come from?
Life, my everyday life, how I move for real. My first year, everything was club. The club, nightlife. Nightlife. Because I stayed in the clubs like that. I was a career clubber. Like, I had the NBA.
She said a career clubber.
I had a real Kobe Bryant league.
Hey, what'd you say? Your jersey retired out that joint.
And I still kind of follow on the. I'm against Carter right now. I'm on the bench. I get in when I can. But I, so that I had so many stories about that. Just different guys approaching you, just how it is, VIPs, those kind of things. And so that crowd could kind of relate to that. So I kind of, that was like the beginning. Then it started being, you know, evolving into just. Be traveling or stuff like that. Or relationships, of course, that kind of thing.
Thanks.
My mother always tells me I need to do more though on in that. Talking relationships, your life. I'm like, so I think this year to 2020 it'll be more
of that.
Like, you know, part like real like my story, my way.
Facts. And I think that's always good to let people see a different side of you.
Yeah. You know, honesty wins, especially now. You see everybody.
Facts.
They record a video.
Yeah, big facts.
On the shitter, like, yeah, I'm out here, that's what I do to talk. Talk toilet talk. Like, yeah. I'm like, oh yeah, we tuning in, she be doing interviews on the toilet. Everything so personal in your face.
She said she do interviews on the toilet, all that's facts though.
Toilet talk. Like, y'all with me, hashtag. They gonna be on their toilet. Anything that's different, anything where you just
low key, that a trend.
What?
That a low key trend.
And let me find out. Talk.
No, let me talk. Don't do it. We gonna do it. No, we ain't doing it. We ain't gonna do it.
And y'all just got the boxes at your.
We ain't gonna do it.
Ankles.
I'm too embarrassed about it. I ain't gonna flex. I almost thought about it.
Somebody brave enough.
I was just gonna say I probably got a send off somewhere around the city that'll do it though.
Know that, but yeah. So I'm just saying. So that honesty wins.
Back,
I think people love. Now, not, I mean, it's always been that, but now more and more people are like, I don't give up, you know what I mean? And you can, they got the platform, and now you can just
get away with it
everywhere.
Yeah, pretty much.
So,
in that sense. Mm-hmm. But I also think that it's still, I mean, it's like the gift and the curse when it comes to that kind of sort of the yin yang. You gotta take kind of the good with the bad when it comes to that, because it could be a lot of good, because we could actually put real content out to the people that's truthful, and not be, you know, no. Well, we know how TV kind of works a little bit. It's scripted, and acted a little bit, so you know how that is. But we can give it to them raw, and right, direct. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one of the things that's kind of benefit for us millennials, that we're able to get out there and do that. And that was one of the things I also wanted to ask, like, how has so much changed, even for you, started from when you start to being where you are now? Because even me, myself, looking at, okay, when I came up, we had just started getting into phones and internet. Y'all remember we had that dial up, you know what I'm saying? You can't get on the phone when you, my mama yelling, get off the internet! I'm like, come on, I gotta need to call somebody! I'm trying to... I'm on AOL trying to, you hear me? Y'all know what I'm talking about. When our minutes, you feel me? You got, hey, call me back after 9, fam. I ain't got my minutes yet. Hold on.
And he's so
now everything unlimited. It's like, right here in your face. You hear me?
Exactly.
We got Call of Duty on the phone. I remember we started with Snake. I had that Nokia. I was snaking the devil. Got my phone, took at school. Y'all know what I'm talking about, man. That's that was that real. Church. Look. Hey.
Yeah, I don't.
I miss
it's
that.
Changed that, like how you shit. Just said it, pretty much. it's changed, like you just said, and it's I don't know now, but I mean, even just from 2 years to now, it's like you in a state where now it's like obligations. You like, did I do this Snap today? Did I do Instagram today? Did I do Facebook today? Did I do?
Yeah, seriously.
So even with just the transition from social media and not now with that, it's gotten even just. I mean, just different, and just, you know what I mean? It just becomes, Instagram just said now they're going to take away the likes so that kids aren't slicing their wrists and being suicidal because they're not getting likes on the picture or whatever. So,
which is kind of backwards in a sense, but...
I don't know, but I'm just saying that even within the social media world or the new, that culture is becoming, it's evolving so fast and so, you know what I mean, that they're trying to get a hold on it. And so, I don't know, it's changed for me because I try to be better with it.
I think with the internet, a lot of us, I ain't gonna say a lot of us, but a lot of people have become more materialistic or entitled to certain things that we, you know what I mean?
I don't know if being materialistic has heightened within the people. I think that now
it seems that it's... But you get what I'm saying though, right?
Meaning like people... Because you can see it so much, you like, ooh.
That's what it is, though.
I want it. But I think those type of people would have been materialistic without it. It's just that they would have been just watching
now
the people
actually
in the streets.
See it. It's like now, okay, if they get on our Instagram and they see us and we out of town, or we over here and we doing like this, or we doing that, whatever, and then they sit at a cubicle, they like, I'm messing, I'm fucking my life up. I should have. Why ain't on vacation? But you just taking it too hard. You could just save your money and go on vacation. Like, I just look at it like, I don't know, I think we put, like, social media puts so much more pressure on everything that doesn't need to be there. Like, I always like to tell people, it's not that we broke, we just don't put our money into things that make us more money. So, you've had some money, but you ain't put it into what it was supposed to do to make you some more money. So, you can't blame nobody else because you live in paycheck.
I don't know if they blaming someone else. I think it's just kind of like, you seeing something, you're like really mad at yourself kind of energy. I don't think you blaming them. You just kind of like, I would like to do that. That's why you get some people who cut social media off. Like, they just like, I've deleted my page. They don't want to see it. They kind of want to stay in their reality, in their time frame. So, I don't know. I have a different feel about that. I kind of think social media doesn't create a certain person. The person creates their social media. So, if I don't want to see search, I don't follow certain things. You know what I mean? It's all algorithm and what you click.
Facts.
So like, if I don't like fight videos and I never click those, they never come in my feed. You know what I mean?
Facts.
If I got somebody of a friend who's close to me who's constantly doing that, oh honey, you gotta go. You know what I mean? So I don't think it's an engine that's without a structure or without a hole. Like, you can control it. You know what I mean? People be like, social media just had me. It's not like this little monster octopus arm making you do shit. Like, no. You can just...
No, kind of in a way, though, because I ain't gonna lie, Facebook creepy as shit.
moves. You know what I'm saying? Now they got it. Listen, program.
Cause you like about just like how right now we talking, right? Factual. Like when I get on Facebook later, they might fuck around and give me your page. Like
you already know. You feel me?
Oh, this is a suggestion to you. Like, hold on, fam, fall back.
No. That's a whole different. That's true. That happens. But
like,
I'm
do you know Blair? I'm like, hold on, man, fall back. I didn't even ask you.
Anything like engagement, just wedding, you just start popping up. If you say happy engagement, girl, they like marriage, rings.
Yeah, it's all crazy.
Oh, no, it is. But I mean, I still have the control to be like, woo, off. I still have the control to be like, X out. Like, that's what I mean. So I think sometimes people use it as a crutch, like, it messed up my relationship. Oh, no, you typed the girl and said, slide, like, you know what I mean? So, right, social media didn't ruin
my man. Yo, Gotti should have made that song. He planted the seed, slide in the DM. You hear me? Hand, I was sliding in the DM, like, Gotti,
you
feel?
Shame on you,
shame on me, shame but should have did it. So, listen, y'all rap niggas gotta stop sending us off, us regular, degular people, okay? Mm. And us regular, degular people gotta stop listening to the people with money because they can get away with that because they got money, you feel me? Uh-huh. People let stuff slide when you got money. Mm-hmm. We not gonna lie about it. If I give you a little cash, you will let a little stuff slide. Be like, you know what I'm saying? He ain't shit, but he just got this and that, so it's okay. I'll let it slide.
You get the benefit of the doubt. One time, maybe.
Okay, one time.
You not abusing nothing out here because you got
corn. No, I know it runs its course because you can't buy love, you can't pay for love, but it gets you out of trouble. We ain't gonna stunt, you hear me? If I get in trouble and I'm like, here, boo babe, here goes some flowers, some candy, some cars, a little money in your pocket, you know what I'm saying? Something with your nails done. Take
Chicago, I take it that he's been in the doghouse a lot.
Yeah, hey, Paul!
And because he got a whole formula.
You got the poof, 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 poof.
That depends on your slip ups, because you might be in the ballpark of like trips, and we talk about White Sands. We talking about,
I
need
bad.
A good deed to an investment property.
I ain't messing with that bad. It's just like regular, degular stuff. Okay. Like, I ain't take the garbage out.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying? Okay. I ain't clean up behind me. I left some chips on the counter or something. Like,
so you didn't have the random cousin?
No, I ain't trying to have none of that.
Meet you in the back.
I don't got time for nothing. Now, back in the day, it was cracking. When we was hooping, y'all know it was a dog style. But now, these days, it's cheaper to keep her.
Okay.
All that happy wife, happy life. It's all the good stuff you hear. You know what I'm saying? You know the stuff you ignored that your granddad and them saying? It's all right now. I'm with it now.
I feel like you've been traumatized.
I am. I have. It's like I've fucked up so much. It's like you gotta be good now, nigga. Like you really don't got no choice.
Use all your nine lives.
Pretty much. And then God only give you three good women in your life. So I probably done burnt out 2.5. So. I only got about a half left, you know what I'm saying? So,
and she on her way.
I'm trying to do good. I'm trying to be right wife. I'm trying to be good. You hear me?
I'm with
Jesus
you.
Name. Okay, so listen, we gonna get to a quick commercial before. I have some sage too, you know what? Facts. And it's some sage over there. Right. Factual, you know what I'm saying? We might have to say, but keep it locked with us right here, man. We're gonna bring it right back. We're gonna talk to the shot, man.
welcome back in here to Talk of the Shot, man. It's your boy Real Quan the Don. Woo! In closing, we're getting ready to wrap everything up right now.
We're done.
Yeah, I'm sorry. We got to get to the end, unfortunately. But with that being said, it's a lot of great things that we can ready to close with.
Okay.
So that's the good part. And so the first thing that we're gonna get to right now is, if there is somebody that's watching us on here right now,
okay,
what words of encouragement can you leave for them? Or if there's a young man or a young woman that wants to follow in the footsteps of you, what's some words of encouragement you can give to them right now?
Let's see. If it's a young lady, I would tell her, get your point.
That part, she ain't lying either.
Yeah,
I'm
just playing. I think, I don't know, my words of encouragement would be, once you figure out like what you love, whatever your passion is, work. And then when you work hard, then work some more. Like, I don't think anybody who's actually put in the sweat, the blood, the energy, they did not come out with what results they wanted. Like, not anyone. There's nobody who'd be like, I did 10 real years consistently and dogged it and didn't get what they, you know what I mean?
What you put in is what you get out.
Exactly. So I think once you, and I always say this to people, or if that's my motivation, because it's honestly to myself. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I think we get in a place where we kind of like feel like you got a little, you know, an idea, and then you kind of get a little laxed, or you know, just American.
Well, some happens, it can make you rethink what you're doing.
Or whatever, fear, procrastination, tons of stuff going on, whatever it is. If you consistently work towards something, Chicago and anybody out there, you will reap the benefits, you will get to where you are. But first find that passion, first find it. And then before that, so we'll do a keep yourself open to opportunities. Gotcha. You never know. Like I said, I did not set out to be in entertainment, and I am really, like, my occupation, I am an entertainer. Gotcha. I love it.
You're here and now. You have arrived. It's real.
Yeah, so just kind of keep yourself open to opportunities. Don't sever relationships. Like, those relationships are so important.
That
you do not want to step on toes. So open yourself to opportunities, maintain great relationships, and then find your passion and work at it.
That's the full kick. That's where it's at right there.
And you're great, and you out here. And then you get to come on his show.
That's for that part. You get to come on and talk your shit on Talk of the Shack, because that's what we do over here. You feel me? We humble, but it's also about gloating about the small things, because I think certain times, and you probably can contest this more, we're living in the moment. Mm-hmm. We don't always accept for what it is. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I don't
know. Like, because we living in it, we don't look at it for what it really is.
Sad part, the fact that you said living in it, like you get to school.
You know, because you're living in it, you know what I'm saying? Like seriously.
I love it, no, you're
like,
right.
Seriously, when I first was playing ball and I got to those levels, I was experiencing it. So mm-hmm. It was like, I wasn't looking at it like that. But for everybody else, it was like, right. You did it. You made it. You there. Like, nice. I've been watching you for a minute. I'm happy to see you there. But for me, it was like, okay, I'm here. What's next? I need to grind. I need to do this. So I wasn't even able to soak it all in to say, I made this goal back when I was a kid, and I actually accomplished it. I actually was a kid from, you know what I'm saying, the south side of Chicago that came from nothing. That's hip. I made it. I did that on my, I can't even say on my own necessarily, but I did the right things that I needed to do to make sure that it happened. Even though I had help and I had family and everybody else around me, but it was just like, I wasn't in the moment to say, yes, I did that. This was a goal and I finally got to the goal. But because I was in it, it was more like, what can I do to get to that next step? Like, what do I got to do? Who do I got to impress? So I wasn't looking at it like that.
And
to
appreciating
enjoy
it. And just kind of saying, you know, taking a moment and saying,
but then
pat
once
yourself
it was all
back.
Over, I was able to say, I'm glad that I got to experience that. I'm glad that my kids got to see me doing that. I'm glad that they got to, you know, be at the games and see me sign autographs and see me doing those things, because it's big. And not only just my kids, my family, my cousins, like everybody else, and I'm sure we all can contest this. It's a different thing when people are looking up to you. Even people that you don't understand are looking up to you. So it kind of gives you a sense of responsibility and humility, like, okay, I gotta make sure I'm on point with what I'm doing because it's bigger than me at this point.
Facts.
And I think that was one of the things that we kind of lose sight of when we end it sometimes. It's bigger than me. I gotta remember my why, my reason to why I do what I do every day, and my purpose behind why I do it, where I come from. So it's like, that's why I wanted to come back home where everything started for me and be grounded and do the work here.
Okay.
Not take my talents and run and be gone, because I could have been balling with the people that got what I need to do, But I was just like, no, my city needs me more than y'all need me. Y'all gonna profit off me. I may profit too, but that's not gonna change what I want to do for my youth and my community and my people, and basically every part of me came from being here.
Exactly.
So why would I take what I gained 10 and then run off and give it to somebody else? They do that all the time anyway. So that was very important for me to come home and create this platform and put that spotlight on the people that don't necessarily get it, that should get it. And the people that are here that don't always get to be heard, I want to make sure that they be heard. So that's what Talk to the Shy is all about. So we like to get who's ever popping, who's ever working, but also those that don't also get the opportunity to show their craft and the things that they doing as well with their work. So that's why we do what we do. So it's always important.
And
to
I appreciate that.
That part. So with that being said, what's your favorite thing to eat here in Chicago? I'm pretty sure you've been a lot of places, right? We done been a lot of places. What's your go-to here?
My go-to here? I'm a vegan. Hey, Chicago.
Hey, nothing
so
wrong with that.
So my go-to is my honest go-to is Whole Foods, but one of my favorite restaurants is Mijani. It's on over east on like 72nd and Exchange. Their weekend brunch is perfect. Like. Absolutely perfect.
Can we get the address to that place? You know,
I don't know. It's on 72nd and Exchange. And it's literally on the corner. So now you say that, like 72nd Exchange. If you go to 72nd and Exchange, you're going to see the sign.
Factual. What's the name of it again?
Mijani. M-A-J-A-N-I.
Mijani. Make sure y'all call and check
so that vegan cuisine is bomb. No, for real. Yeah, let me plug them.
Look, plug.
So like, oh, this is a great boy. But no, I do. That's the go-to. Besides Whole Foods, just Reagan Hot Bar, East Side Bar, and that's like when I drop down. Actually, any city, but in Chicago.
Factual. Ain't nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
All right, so now we're going to get into our Would You Rather. You feel me?
What's that? So,
you said what's that?
What is it?
Would you rather? We finna ask the question. I ain't got to the damn question yet. You got to let me ask you the question first.
All right.
So, we understand that you have a background in dance, but you also are now a comedian, right? Mm-hmm. So the question that I want to ask you is, would you rather have a sold-out show for dance or a sold-out show as a comedian? Like, which one would matter more to you and why?
I would rather have a sold-out show in comedy because it's just me. Normally, because I've actually done sold-out shows with dance. I did the VMAs, I did the BET Awards, I've done, you know what I mean? I've done concerts everywhere. And they're amazing. I mean, I did the Essence Fest, I did tons of stuff with like thousands and thousands of people. Super Bowl 49, so. But
okay,
But comedy is like my baby. You know what I mean? It's like directly like my work. So even if I do like some choreography, it's still the dancers kind of putting it out. And so the artists in front of us. So comedy, a sold out show, will really, it's a direct reward or indicator of like what you did. So dang, I did this. I brought these people, or I promoted, or I. So it's an instant gratification, but it's also more of a substantial one because it's directly from me. So a sold out comedy. And that's what I really want to, will be doing. You know what I mean? I will be the Dick Gregory. Like, it'll be forever.
Fashion.
I mean, I can't be busting and dropping it. 50, 60. I mean, I could give you a little something, but I don't know. I'd be footworking at 70. But
fact,
I could be sitting on a good chair or telling jokes at 85, 90. So
fact,
that's what I really want to be doing. So sold out That's, I would rather be sold out than comedy show.
Facts, right? Nothing wrong with that. So with that being said, you got any shout outs that you want to give to the people?
Shout out to all my people in Uptown. No, and
that part. Hey, Uptown, shout out to my people in Uptown too, man. Y'all know who y'all are, man.
Yeah.
That part.
Shout out to all the queens out there making moves. All my fellow queens who are working, who are in the industry, who are making decisions and deciding and just saying that choice, like, this is what I want, this is what I'm going to get. Because that is always a plus, and that's always like a motivating thing to me. You know what I mean? Seeing just black women in the essence and in their zone. Shout out to, I don't know, the world of Blair Christian, everybody who's been supporting Rockin' since I was like dancing on Element Company to now. And then shout out to Talking
to
Shy for having me
here.
Hey.
We get a shout out too. I feel lucky now. Hey, let me say that.
And just catch me, the handles, everything is Blair Christian. So not everything but the word, but just Blair Christian on Snap, Blair Christian on IG, Blair Christian on Facebook, and Blair Christian on whatever other engine is about.
I mean, I was going to ask you where the people can find you, but that's where they can find you, right there. You feel me? So we just, hey. Just took the words out of my motherfucking mouth. Hey, so
that's where they find
follow me. Your boy at realquandadon_ on Instagram and just quandadon on Facebook as always.
Quandadon,
that part, you hear me?
No, he from Chicago.
Since we talk about Uptown too, man, shout out to Kenyatta as well. She be
hey,
doing
Kenyatta.
Her yeah, you hear me? You hear me? Hand. She be doing her thing on the basketball set. I recently seen her on the team with my cousin as well.
So wait. Shout out to DNA, DNA Management, Enzo, Patrick, T Mac, that the whole new team. That's it. Oh, shout out to
look, you know black people. Shout out to Lil Pat too, you know what I'm saying? No, I don't even know no Lil Pat, but you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, shout out to all the folks working and making it happen.
Nah, that part though, for real. And I appreciate you coming on the platform.
Thank you for
it was
having
excellent
me.
Having you.
Yay.
We gotta have some more things coming up in the future. So any projects that you're working on, no, tell us to come out. We gonna come out.
Oh, wow, and that's
skits. We do the whole whatever. You hear me? We can put
say
something
no more.
Together.
Say less. We out.
That's what it do. All straight like that, man. So hey, make sure y'all always keep locked. We're talking to Shy, man. Make sure y'all subscribe to everything that we're doing. But until next time, man, keep locked with us right here on Top of the Shy. You did.
Awesome.
Quantadon Productions, baby.
Comedian Blair Christian here, and I just finished this super dope, bomb, superb interview with the Talk of the Shy. So, if you would like to see more dope artists like myself, click and also subscribe.